many courses and after the physics course. The physics course will be covered in 3 months. We'll be taking 2 classes each week on Tuesdays and Thursdays. So the entire medical physics course, physics syllabus will be covered. And we are going by the sequence that is there in Faizan M. Khan's medical physics book from first chapter to last chapter. So those who wants to ask any question can write it or type it in Q&A section. Don't type it in chat section, type it in Q&A section. And we have already reached our limit. Almost 500 people have joined. So I think we can start the course. And I welcome our first speaker. We'll be talking today on atomic structure and nuclear transformation, Dr. Deepak Bhattacharya. Dr. Deepak Bhattacharya is a young dynamic radiation oncologist. He is consultant in Apollo Gleneagles Hospital, Kolkata. And he will be taking the first class. And I hope everybody will enjoy the class and everybody will be benefited. So let us welcome Dr. Deepak Bhattacharya. And now I hand over this mic to Dr. Deepak Bhattacharya. Dr. Deepak Bhattacharya, please.
Thank you, sir. So good evening, everybody. I would like to thank the Young Radiation Oncologist Club for giving me the opportunity to present today. And particularly, topic of atomic structure and nuclear transformation is very close to my heart. And so I have tried to make it as interesting as possible. So let's start the atomic structure. So if you trace through the history, you will find that the concept of atom was generated in almost 400 before the year 400 before Christ. And it was at the same time in the Greece by Democritus and Kanad in India has found the concept of atom as the indestructible element of the nature. And that if you start cutting something one by one and again, and you'll find something when you cannot cut it further. So they named it as atom. So for next 2000 years, nobody actually was interested to know about atom. And then at around 1800, John Dalton first published the atomic theory, who said that, who just identified that atoms are solid particles of element, which are different elements, and for different elements, they differ in size, mass, and other properties. He did not go to any further detail. Now, the most interesting part started as early as 1897, when the British scientist J.J. Thomson was experimenting with his cathode rays. At that time, the cathode ray was named as Leonard rays. So what he found was that there are some subatomic particle coming out of the elements which are very lighter or smaller than the atom actually, and which is almost 1,000 times smaller or lighter than the atom and having a negative charge. And this was common for all elements, I mean, irrespective of all elements. So this might be something common for all elements. So he named these negatively charged particles as corpuscles, and these were later named as electrons. So we found the first subatomic particle of electron. Now, J.J. Thomson also gave a model of atom, which is known as plum pudding model, which is a British desert, where you can see the resins are scattered in the pudding. And he said that the entire atom is basically a soup of positive material in which we have negative electrons pumps scattered discretely. Now, after that came the famous experiment by Ernest Rutherford, who was born in New Zealand and later established in England. So he found that. So he found that this in the gold foil experiment, he bombarded the gold foil with the alpha particles, which are basically positively charged heavy particles. So these heavy particles, he found that most of the particles are going through and through the gold foil, but some of them are deflected and some of them are just coming 180 degree back. So from this experiment, he concluded that the atom, which is basically a hollow structure, which is mainly the hollow structure, that is most of the part of the atom is empty. And the center of the atom, there is something some positive charge which holds these negative electrons by electrostatic force. And he said that these atoms rotates, these electrons rotate around the nucleus in a planetary fashion as the planets moves around the sun. So if you see the diameter, the nucleus has a diameter of 10 to the power minus 15 meter, while the atom has a diameter of 10 to the power minus 10. So rest of the space is empty. That's why the alpha particles were crossing through. Now, the Rutherford model had some limitations. That is, according to the theory of classic physics by Maxwell, he said that if a charged particle is accelerated, it will emit energy in form of electromagnetic radiation or electromagnetic wave. So if the Rutherford model says, as the Rutherford model says, that the electron is moving continuously, so it will continuously emit some energy. So it should be that the energy should look like a continuous spectrum. But in reality, from the atoms, we get discrete energy spectrum. So by that, the Rutherford model cannot explain this spectrum. On the other hand, if, as per the Maxwell's theory, if the electron moves in angular momentum, it will lose its energy because it will continuously radiate. So his orbit will be shrinking continuously and ultimately it will fall into the nucleus. And thus, with positive and negative colliding with each other, the stability of atom will be lost. So the Rutherford model cannot describe the stability of atom. During this time also, famous scientists Max Planck and Albert Einstein, both of them developed a new concept of the light or energy, which is known as the quantum theory. That means they found that the light is no longer is a continuous source of energy, but they are actually packets of energy, or they named them as quanta or photons. So by this concept and with the drawback of the Rutherford models, Niels Bohr, who was also working with Rutherford, he developed a new concept of the atom. That is, the nucleus remains same in the center of the atom, but what he said is that the electrons rotate surrounding the nucleus, but in a fixed orbits only. And the angular momentum of this electrons in this fixed orbit are constant, and that is explained by the Planck's constant. So in this particular orbits, according to Bohr model, that the electrons will not emit any energy or not absorb any energy. So the stability of nucleus can be explained by this model. And he also said that when the electron absorbs some energy from the inner shell, it will jump into an outer shell. And if it loses energy and it goes into the inner shell, it will give some energy, and thus we can have the discrete energy spectrum according to the jump from one shell to another. So this was given by Niels Bohr. Now, what is happening within the nucleus now? So Rutherford subsequently, a few years later, found that when the air is bombarded with alpha particle, they found that the hydrogen nucleus are, you can find the hydrogen nuclear are scintillating in the scintillators. So he found that the hydrogen nucleus must be one of the building block of the nucleus, which is responsible for the positively charged particle. And he also found that these particles are actually 1836 times heavier than the electron, which was developed previously. He named them as proton, as the fast particle of the nucleus. He also thought there must be something else too in the nucleus to which is responsible for the stability of the nucleus and the mass, but he did not further conclude about the other particle. Now the other scientists started to find what is the other particle. So they found that when a very light metal like the beryllium, they are bombarded with alpha particles, like heavy particles, they found the unknown radiation is being formed. And these are neutral in nature. So unlike alpha particle or proton or electron, which were previously charged, this radiation is uncharged. That means it cannot be deflected by electromagnetic field. So they initially found whether it is a gamma ray. But they observed that among these scientists were the Irene Curie and who established in Paris. They found that when the paraffin wax is to this unknown radiation, this paraffin wax, which is highly concentrated with hydrogen atom, they produce atom. That means this radiation must have a very high energy or mass so that they can expel protons from the paraffin wax molecule. So James Chadwick was a student of Rutherford. He established that this highly penetrating uncharged particle as particles rather than gamma ray. And he named them as neutrons according to their neutral charge. So with that, we'll come to a break with our current structure of the atomic structure. That is the nucleus inside with proton and neutron, proton being positively charged, electrons are moving around it in the K shell, L shell, according to the Bohr's definition. And the number of electron is same with the proton to keep the atom neutral. And the outside electron, which are known as valence electron. Now with that, we know how to describe an element. That is, the X is the symbol of element, like this helium. Z is the atomic number or the proton number, that is 2 for helium. And A is the mass number, which is basically the number of proton plus neutron in the nucleus. This proton and nucleus is also known as proton and neutron is also known as nucleons, which constitute the nucleus. Now with that, I've given some important charges and masses of all these particles. And you can see the proton and neutron has almost similar mass, and while electron is much lighter than them. And the electron and proton share the same charges, but in a different opposite, and they're opposite to each other. Now coming to some definitions, one atomic mass unit, which is a unit to represent the mass, is basically 1/12 of the mass of a neutral carbon 12 atom, which equals to 1.66 into 10 to the power minus 27 kg. And the electron volt is often used in our radiation oncology subject, which can be defined as it is the kinetic energy acquired by an electron when it is accelerated in a potential difference of 1 volt. So basically electron volt is the measure of energy, and it can be explained by the joule also. And 1 keV is equal to 1000 electron volt, and 1 million electron volt is equal to 10 to the power 6 electron volt. And this 1 MeV is very frequently used in our radiation oncology. This MeV unit is very frequently used in our radiation oncology system for describing the energy of radioactive isotopes. And also according to Einstein's formula of E equal to mc square, the resting electron energy can be converted to equal to 0.511 MeV. Now coming to continuation of the atomic structure. So the limitation of Bohr model was that the Bohr model was worked beautifully when it was applied to hydrogen atom or helium ion, where there is only one electron is there. But when there is more complex atom and more electron with producing complex spectrum, Bohr model could not explain it properly. And it also could not explain some other effect, which are known as Zeeman effect or Stard effect, where it showed that the spectrums are actually having fine lines rather than one line when they are exposed to magnetic or electric field. I'll not go into detail of the electron distribution further, but with this limitation of Bohr model, further models were developed by Sommerfeld Bohr model, who said that the electrons are the electron orbits are not always circular but also elliptical, and the path is it follows a rosette pattern. But till date, the pattern of electron distribution was 2D. The next hypothesis came from de Broglie, who is a French scientist, who said that not only the wave can behave like particle, as said by Maxwell, said by Max Planck and Einstein. He said that the particles can also behave like waves. So the electrons at the smaller mass like electron, the particle may also behave like wave, by which you can actually justify the nature of electron. And further, concept was further added by Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, who showed that you cannot determine the position or momentum, that is the energy of the electron, simultaneously. So either you have to go for the momentum or position, So in the atom, the position of electron and or the momentum of electron is uncertain. And he said that the concept came like the basically electrons remain as a cloud in the or 3D region where it can be found in 90% time. And this equation was, these were mathematically represented by Schrodinger in 1926 by his model of quantum wave mechanical model of standing wave. So we have come to the quantum mechanical model of atom. So we will not discuss about electron anymore, but we will discuss about the nucleus. So as we know, the nucleus is having positive charges. That means multiple protons, which are positively charged. Now, as the electrostatic force, we know the positive charges repel each other. But how the nucleus exists then? Because the positive charge, the proton should repel each other, but how they come together and exist simultaneously. So for that, we come to the forces of nature. So we have four forces of nature, and they are distributed according to their from weak to strongest, weakest to strongest. So the first one, which is the gravitational force, is found to be the weakest of all forces, and it is applicable for large masses. We all know about gravitational force. The next force is known as the weak nuclear force, or rather it is known as the Fermi's interaction force, which acts in a very short distance in a subatomic level or maybe a distance of proton, but it is much stronger than gravity, and it is usually associated with different types of radioactive decay like beta decay. The next one is the electromagnetic force. We all know about electromagnetic force, that the opposite charges attract each other and the same charges repel each other. Now this is also active in for short distance only. Now we come to the strongest of all, that is the strong nuclear force, which can explain how the protons are held in the nucleus. The strongest, these are active in subatomic level only, and they are responsible for the stability of nucleus. Now, how the strong nuclear force is generated? The theory is that, as we know, the nucleus is consisting of neutron and protons. Now, the neutrons and protons, if you join their masses, so the mass of nucleus should be equal to the neutron and proton. But in practical, it finds that the nucleus is having a mass lesser than the summation of the mass of neutron and proton. So some of the mass is destroyed, which is known as the mass defect. And the concept is that this mass is converted to energy, and this mass acts as a glue to keep the nucleons together. Coming to the further description of this particular strong nuclear force. So this strong nuclear force is acting in a very small area or the radius of the nucleus, where if a proton approaches the atom from outside from an infinity range, it will face is a repulsion force due to the electrostatic force because it is positively charged. So there will be a barrier so it will require more energy to cross the barrier. But once it crosses the barrier of this electrostatic force or the Coulomb force, it will suddenly lack this barrier and it will be attracted within the nucleus by the strong nuclear force. So you have to take the proton to a certain extent, to a very short distance towards the nucleus to have the strong nuclear force. And this is known as a potential well where the protons are attracted. Very few words about the elementary particles. With time, it was discovered that the proton neutrons are not something which cannot be further divided. It was found that the protons and neutrons are basically made of some quarks, which are also known as fermions. And this glue thing, which is basically keeping them together, is done by the gluons, which are also type of elementary bosons. We will not go into further detail for the elementary particles. Now, with that, we come to some other important definition, which are known as isotope, isotones, isobars, isomers. So, what are isotopes? Isotopes are basically two atoms with similar proton number. How to remember? P for P. So, the proton number will be similar for the two atoms, but the atomic weights are different. Isotones are similarly N for N, that is, the neutron numbers are equal for both the atoms, but the proton numbers are different. So in here, you see, in both cases, the neutron number is 7. Now come to isobars. They are basically with same number of nucleons, that is 58. They are called isobars. And lastly, isomers. The isomers are basically similar atom, but at a different energy states. We'll talk more about the isomers when we'll talk about radioactivity. Now coming to the nuclear stability. So as we are saying, if you see the periodic table, that as we increase the number of protons, that the Z number, the neutron number also increases. And if you plot the Z number and the neutron number in the X and Y axis respectively, you see that this is the ratio of N by P, or known as N by P, where Z equal to N. So you can see up to 20 atomic number, the actual elements follow more or less N by P of 1. And then they starts moving towards the neutron side. And if you see this black line, which is basically the line of stable nucleus who maintain more or less a stable neutron to proton ratio. But as they grow towards either towards this blue side, either towards the neutron side or towards the proton side, they become unstable because of either more number of neutron or more number of proton, or if it goes beyond 82, that is the lead, which is the most stable compound, it becomes unstable due to heavy weight. So they try to become stable by emitting some particles or some energy to become stable. So over 300 isotopes are distributed in such way. So by the way they emit this is all known as the radioactivity. So if you see the radioactive nucleus, what happens in normal nuclear, the kinetic energy of the particles are not sufficient to penetrate or escape the nuclear barrier. But in radioactive nucleus, they have some excess energy which is redistributed in the nucleons. By probability, they may escape and the nuclear achieves a lower state of energy, and they can further go to step down to a further lower step when emitting particles or by emitting some energy to the ground state. Now this phenomena, which is known as by which the radiation is given off from the nuclei of element, is known as radioactivity, which was discovered by Henri Becquerel, who was a French scientist in 1896. And this can be either particle or can be electromagnetic radiation or can be both. So what he did, he got interested in phosphorescence study. And when Sir Röntgen developed X-ray, he thought that there must be some similarity with the phosphorescence with the X-ray. And he started experimenting with uranium salt, and he found that uranium salt can give three types of radiation. One is a light particulate radiation, which is negatively charged and deflected in the magnetic field. One is heavier particulate radiation, which is positively charged and deflected in an opposite field. And there are some other radiation, which is basically energy, which is not influenced by any magnetic field. So actually, these were alpha ray, beta ray, and gamma rays. And for this discovery with Pierre Curie and the famous Curie couples, Pierre Curie and Marie Curie, the three of them received Nobel Prize for the discovery of radioactivity, and the Madame Curie named the term radioactivity, who later discovered radium and polonium in their research on fish plane. Now coming to the types of decay. So as we have already said, the elements want to become stable by decaying some particles. So to see how to decay, so if you see these elements which are orange, they are having more protons, right? Because they are having more Z number. So they will try to decay by some positive particles or in mode so that they get rid of protons and they go towards more neutron. While the opposite is observed for the for the blue particles. I'll come to that. So with that, we come to the types of radioactive decay. So in any decay, these five things remains always constant. That is the total energy of the system, the momentum, which is equivalent to energy, the charge, the atomic number, and the atomic mass number. There is no destruction. So coming to the first type of decay, alpha decay. The alpha decay happens when the atom becomes very heavy. That is, the 82 is the number of lead, proton number of lead. So lead is the most stable compound, as I've already said, most stable element, beyond which the elements become unstable because of their weight. So they decay by mass, which is the helium nucleus or a combination of two neutrons and two protons. So they give rise to alpha particles, and along with that, they also give some disintegrating energy. The alpha particle takes this energy and comes out of it of the atom with kinetic energy. And as the atom has much heavier weight than the alpha particle, the energy and the kinetic energy received by the atom is much less. Now, the classical example of alpha decay is radon, radium. The radium decays by alpha decay to form the radons. So this region is the decay of alpha. Now coming to the next type of decay, which is known as beta particle decay. So beta particle decay, as we said, that for this area who has more neutron, what they will do, one neutron will be converted to one proton, one negatron, or which is equivalent to electron, but because it is coming from nucleus, it is caused as beta minus or negatron, and one antineutrino. So this is possible because we now know that proton, neutron are all made of quarks and they are interchangeable. So now this way the atom will decay by beta negative or negatron emission. So this is the area of negatron emission because they need to get rid of the high neutron count and they wants to go towards the proton side. Now oppositely, the proton side will divide into one neutron, one neutrino, and one beta positive particle, or which is known as the positron. And this positron, they will want to get stability. So this is known as positron emission. Eventually the positron cannot stay and it will react with another electron in the system and will develop annihilation reaction. So these are the example of beta particle decay or negatron emission. Cobalt 60 source decays by beta particle decay, which is the classical example of beta particle decay, and it forms a nickel source, which is radioactive, which is in a metastable form of isomer of nickel. We'll come to know what happens next to the nickel in later part. Now coming to the positron emission, sodium 22 typically decays by positron emission and forms a neutrino and beta particle with this disintegration energy. Now coming to another mode, which is known as electron capture, often seen in iodine and tellurium, when an electron which is close to in the closest orbit is captured within the nucleus due to strongest force of attraction. And what will happen, the electron is a negative one, so it will react with the proton to form a neutron and a neutrino. Thus, the electron is captured in the nucleus will create a hole or vacancy in the orbit. So this vacancy will be immediately filled up from one electron from the outer orbit. So as per the Bohr's theory, for jumping of electron from this part to that part, it will emit some radiation. So either it will emit the energy as form of radiation, which is known as characteristic X-ray or phosphorescence X-ray. Why characteristic X-ray? Because it is characteristic of this particular jump from this orbit to this orbit. And otherwise, if the characteristic X-ray is absorbed by this one outer shell electron or free electron, absorb the energy and it will have the energy to move out of the binding energy, and this will go out of the electron, which is known as Auger electron. So this is known as characteristic X-ray and this is known as Auger electron. So this is Auger electron phenomena is mostly seen in low atomic number masses, while characteristic X-ray is characteristic of high atomic number masses. So this is electron capture phenomena where also the atom is getting rid of proton. So electron capture also occurs in this side of the NP ratio curve. Now coming to the isomeric transition of gamma decay. So here, as we know, the cobalt 60 is decayed by beta, but which forms a nickel 60, which is basically, you can see the proton number has changed, so the element is changed, but it becomes with the energy in a high energy non-metastable state. So it will emit in two steps, two gamma rays of two different energies. See, this is the MeV. This is why I was talking about the MeV. This is the energy of gamma rays, and will become stable by emitting this energy. And this is the classical cobalt decays, cobalt 60 decay scheme, which is often asked in exams. But so the decay of initially by beta, and they will decay by two separate gamma rays. And if you see, the average energy will be around 1.25 MeV by averaging these two energies. So another form of radioactive decay is internal conversion, where a radioactive nucleus will emit some energy and will give it to the electron which is close to the nucleus. And this electron, by absorbing this huge energy, will release the binding energy and go out of the atom. So again, a shell will be created, vacant shell will be created, where the electron will jump from outer surface, and again it will give rise to characteristic X-ray or Auger electron, similar to the electron capture phenomena. So with that, we complete the radioactive decay type. Now let's come to the properties of electromagnetic radiation, which was given by Maxwell. So by this time, we know that there are two types of radiation, either in form of particle, that is alpha particle or beta particle, or in form of the electromagnetic radiation like gamma rays, which are basically energy. And as we know, this energy, this electromagnetic radiation can be explained by two types. One is the wave model of energy or the quantum model. The wave model is where it looks like a wave, or the quantum model where they can be explained by packets of energy. So these were, the wave model was described by Maxwell. They said that the electromagnetic wave basically oscillates in two fields, the electric field and the magnetic field. And this electric field and magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other at a given instant. And also, the direction of the electromagnetic wave is in Z axis. So if the electric force is in X axis and the electric force is in X axis and the magnetic force is in Y axis, the electromagnetic wave will go in the Z axis. So the three axes can be defined. The energy of the electromagnetic wave is that it can propagate to a speed of light. And it has got a spectrum of 10 to the power 7 to 10 to the power minus 13 meter. So it ranges from the radio waves to very high energy X-ray waves. This is the electromagnetic radiation. In contrast, if you see the particulate radiation, they cannot attain the speed of light. Rather, according to theory of Einstein, if they want to attain the speed of light, they will gain mass according to the theory of relativity. And how you can explain this wave or quantum model by these two equations? If you see, the C is the velocity of light, and V, this nu, is basically the frequency, and lambda is the wavelength. So this is the wavelength. And or if you want to explain the quantum model, that is the energy model, energy is equal to H nu, where H is the Planck's constant, or H C by lambda. From this equation, C is the energy of, C is the velocity of light. Now coming to a few other important units and measurement for radioactivity. So what is decay constant? So it is seen that naturally the number of atoms that disintegrate per unit time, that is the disintegration rate, is usually proportional to the number of atoms which is present initially in a radioactive atom. So the disintegration rate is proportional to the initial number of atoms present. So from which we can derive a constant which is known as lambda, or decay constant, which is denoted as negative because the number will decrease with time because of the decay. From here, by logarithmic expression, we can get this equation where n is the number of atom present at a time of t, and after a certain amount of decay, after the time of t, and n0 being the initial number. The same thing can be extrapolated in another equation of the activity. So activity is basically defined as, it is the rate of decay of a radioactive material, that is the number of disintegrations per unit time or second. So if you see this model, the number of atoms disintegrating per unit time is basically this dN by dt, which can be replaced by activity. And from here, we can derive the similar equation for calculating activity also, where A0 is the primary activity. So the activity will decrease with time according to its decay constant. So the decay constant is it will vary according to the element. And for a particular radioactive atom, the decay constant will be specific. So according to that, the half-life will be determined, which will I will come next. So what are the units of activity? It's very important. Becquerel, as per the name of Henri Becquerel, which is basically one disintegration per second or DPS and one Curie. This is the SI unit, and one Curie is most commonly used unit. The Curie is basically rate of decay of 1 gram of radium, which is equivalent to 3.7 into 10 to the power 10 DPS. The way the Curie unit was given at that time, it was found that the radium's decay is 3.7 into 10 to the power 10 DPS, but later it was found that it is not actually 3.7, but it's around 3.66. But however, for the definition purpose, one Curie is defined as 3.7 into 10 to the power 10 DPS. And if you see the relation between Becquerel and Curie, the Becquerel is usually 2.7 into 10 to the power minus 11 Curie. One Curie is equal to 3.7 into 10 to the power 10 Becquerel, as it is equal to one disintegration per second. Now coming to some other properties of radioactive materials, that is specific activity. Specific activity is basically the activity per unit mass. That means how much activity is there within a unit mass of a material. So you can see if the specific activity is high, that means a smaller amount of material can have more activity. So this property is exploited in tracer elements for studying biochemical process, where a very small amount of radioactive material can be injected in the body, which will not take part in metabolic interference or cause metabolic interference because it is so small in amount, but will give some measurable activity. And for radiation oncology, we use this specific activity to determine the size of teletherapy or brachytherapy sources. As you see, if you have a high specific activity, you can make smaller size of radioactive sources, which could be useful because the smaller size of radioactive teletherapy source can have smaller penumbra, and smaller size of brachytherapy source is easy to use and easy to be inserted in the body. So if you see what are the ideal nature of a brachytherapy source, you will see high specific activity is one of the most important criteria for an ideal brachytherapy source. So it can be explained that why cobalt-60, despite having a half-life of 5.26 years, in contrast to cesium with 137 of 30 years of half-life, why cobalt-60 is preferred over cesium? Because the specific activity of cobalt-60 is much more than the cesium. Now coming to one of the most important phenomena, which is known as half-life. So what is half-life? So half-life is basically a measurement of a time. So it is a time required for something to become half. What to become half? It is the activity or the number of the radioactive atom to decay to its half of the initial value. So that it is the time required for either the activity or the number of radioactive atoms to decay to half of the initial value. This is known as half-life. So let's see what is this. So if you see the number of radioactive nuclei was 1, so after a certain time it will become 0.5 or half. Then again, after a certain time, it will become 1/4, then 1/8, 1/16. So it will decay in an exponential fashion. So it will never reach zero because it is decaying in an exponential fashion. So but you can see the decay, this distance for each half is equal. So this is known as the half-life, which is basically the time. So this curve for a mathematical expression can be represented in a semi-logarithmic curve with a straight line for further calculation. So the calculation of half-life is that, so we have this equation in mind that N is the number of radioactive element at a certain time, and which is equal to the initial elements to the power lambda is the decay constant, and T is the at a given time. So if you see, if you want to make it half, so N by N0 will be half. So if the N by N0 is half, then you need to find what is the time required to become N by N0 to reach half the value. So that is called as T half. If T is replaced by T half, then you see the it is basically 0.693 by lambda. So now I have already told you the lambda is the decay constant for a particular element. So for a particular element, T half will be fixed. As we have already told, for the cobalt 60, the T half is around 5.26 years, and the for cesium it is around 30 years. So for a particular radioactive element, half life will be fixed, and that can be derived by this formula. So coming to one more thing, which is known as mean or average life, it is particularly useful for some calculation. The average life means, suppose the source which is rather than decaying in the exponential pattern, so suppose it decays in a constant rate equal to the initial activity, and you sum all the lifespan or the decays of the all radioactive elements, and you divide by the number of radioactive initial number of radioactive atoms present, so you get something which is known as the average lifetime. So it is useful for some mathematical calculation, and is also can be represented by the Greek letter tau. The T average is basically 1.44 of the into the half life. So by this you can calculate half life, average life. Now coming to one more phenomenon, which is known as radioactive equilibrium. So this occurs when you have a radioactive material which disintegrates to form another material, which is known as a daughter product. And the daughter product itself becomes a radioactive one. So suppose in here, the radium gives rise to radon. And this radon is again a daughter product, but again radioactive. So when this kind of situation occurs, that the parent and daughter both are radioactive, both the decay or the activity of this both isotopes becomes the ratio of the activity becomes constant after a certain time. So like here, when and that depends on the half-life of the parent and daughter molecule, daughter elements. If the half-life of the parent molecule is much more than the half-life of the radon with the daughter molecule, as in the radon gas, only 3.8, which is negligible to 1622 years of radium's half-life, it will reach an equilibrium which is known as a secular equilibrium. That means the initially there will be no radon when the radium is there, and the radio it will as the radium starts decaying to radon, the radon gets accumulated in the system and it will increase in number. But as you see, the time to become radon to radium is much longer because of the high half life. After certain around 7 half lives, the radon amount of radon in the system and the activity will become almost equal. The activity will come into equal when, and they will reach an equilibrium. This is known as secular equilibrium. While if the similar thing occurs but with a smaller half life for the parent element, where the half-life of the parent element is not that small, not that long than the daughter element, the equilibrium achieved is different. This is a classical example of this transient equilibrium, where the molybdenum, which is used to create this metastable technetium, which is used in different medical application, the once the system starts generating molybdenum, quickly it reaches the equilibrium and they reach the ratio of a constant ratio of parent and daughter activity, and this reaches by usually 4 half lives. And this system is also known as the cow. Like every time the technetium is generated from the molybdenum, and some amount of technetium is always generated and can be taken out of the system for the purpose of medical, as milking of the cow for the purpose of medical experiments or interventions. Now lastly, we'll come to the nuclear reactions. We'll not go into very details of nuclear reaction. There are different types of nuclear reaction, and basically nuclear reactions are the reaction between the alpha particle, protons or neutrons with the nucleus, and they form different types of change in the elements and different types of energy emission I will come to one or two of them, specifically the neutron bombardment, which is very commonly used for generation of radioactive nuclides or radioactive isotopes, which we commonly use in our radiation oncology practice. Most of the artificial isotopes are prepared by neutron bombardment, which causes the which does not change the element but changes the atomic number and makes them radioactive, which will later in a reactor, which will later cause a decay by radioactive decay of beta particle decay and gamma ray emission. Now another thing is the fission reaction, which is basically sometimes called a spontaneous fission or fission by neutron, or especially the thermal or the slow neutrons, which are very efficient for this fission reaction. When a particular element like uranium is bombarded with thermal or slow neutron, it will initially generate an element which will spontaneously break into few other elements, and which will give rise to few more fast neutrons also, and will release massive amount of energy. And this fission reaction is also a form of decay. It is also classified as a type of decay, where a particular element is spontaneously broken into some smaller elements and gives rise to enormous amount of energy. And this particular idea is exploited in the nuclear reactors to produce huge amount of energy for use as a power generator. So what happens in the nuclear reactor? Basically, the neutron first bombards one uranium molecule, which is basically the fuel which is inside the nuclear reactor, and which gives rise to subsequent energy release and some other fast neutrons, which will again bombard some other uranium, and thus initiate a chain reaction when a sufficient amount of uranium is present in the source, in the system. And these neutrons are sometimes very fast, and they are converted into slow neutrons by some moderators like graphite, heavy water, so that they become slow and they can again interact with the uranium. And thus the power generated can be used for some other purposes. So with that, I would like to conclude our first class on atomic structure and nuclear activity. I would like to thank the Young Radiation Oncologist Club for giving the opportunity, and my team Apollo Kolkata, Dr. Sayan Pal, Dr. Tanvi Shahi, Dr. Mukti Mukherjee, Dr. Shantam Chakravarti, Dr. Moses Arun Singh, Dr. Kanucharan Patro, Dr. Sayan Das, Dr. Rashi Agarwal, and Dr. Riddhi Jyoti Talukdar, who has given enormous time to create the Zoom platform as well as the YouTube platform, so that we can simultaneously play in the both the platforms over past 2 days. And I would also like to thank our departmental, my seniors and colleagues for giving their feedbacks during the presentation, my teacher and my cousin sister, who is a professor of chemistry, who also guided for this presentation. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. It was an excellent class, I must say. Very, 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 very interesting. And I hope the students will be benefited by this class. We have few questions in Q&A section.
Okay.
So, if you want me to read it out, or if you can read this, you can answer these questions.
Okay. Give me 1 minute, please.
Yeah. First one was, please explain nuclear forces and energy graph by Dr. Deepak Ari.
Okay. So I'll go to the slide.
Yeah.
Okay. So as we discussed that we have four forces in nature, and I'll not go into the gravitational force. So you wanted to know about the nuclear forces. So in the nucleus, which is a very very short subatomic, which you can use a microscopic thing rather in a very short distance, gravitational force does not work. So gravitational force is not some force which can work in the nucleus. So mainly these three forces acts in the nucleus. So coming to the most easy one, there's the electromagnetic force, which we all know that the same charge, sorry for the grammatical mistake, the same charges repel each other, the negative charges will repel and the opposite charge will attract. So this is happening in the nuclear nucleus. It is easy to understand. So when an electron comes towards the proton, it will attract. And if two protons come towards each other, it can repel. And it can be explained that when we are talking about the radioactivity, when the proton number is very high in a particular system or a particular nucleus, you can think that the diameter of nucleus will increase. And as the diameter of nuclear increases, the distance between the two proton will increase. As the distance between the two proton increases, it will go beyond the strong nuclear force. As soon as it goes beyond strong nuclear force, the electromagnetic force will act and they will repel each other. So they will try to go away from the nucleus. By that, you can basically explain how the proton wants to go out or wants to decay by beta positive decay. That is one thing. Now coming to weak nuclear force. The weak nuclear force is actually also known as the interaction. Basically, it is not said about force, rather it is described as an interaction which was given by Enrico Fermi. So it also acts in a very short distance, maybe at a distance of a size of a proton, and is stronger than gravity. And if you see the elementary particle, you can see the bosons, which are basically which is a type of elementary particles, with this W and Z, these are the bosons or the elementary particles which have some force fields, and they basically are responsible for this kind of interaction. So by this interchange of this force field molecules, the proton and neutron can change with each other. And so that, as we have seen in the beta particle decay, so these interactions are basically guided by the weak nuclear force or Fermi's interaction. Now coming to the strong nuclear force, which you are asking about. The strong nuclear force is something which binds the proton. Even they are positively charged, the strong nuclear force can bind them. So there must be something unique. So that is, in a very short radius, the strong nuclear force is so active that the protons can actually ignore their repulsive force and they can become together. So if you take a proton which is a positively charged from an infinite distance towards the atom, so initially it will feel the repulsive force because of the positive charge of the nucleus, but somehow it has got enough energy to cross the maximum repulsive force, which is known as the potential barrier, then it will come into the field of the strong nuclear force and it will be a part of nucleus. Hope I could explain that.
Dr. Jeevak. So now the second question is, cobalt 60 have two energy, why it is called monoenergetic? And third one is, what is the use of average half-life?
Okay, so first thing is that the average half-life is basically something used for calculation of quick calculation of some amount of radioactive material in the in some system. And now coming to the first question, that is why it is called monoenergetic. Basically, the monoenergetic and polyenergetic beam concept comes from X-ray versus the nuclear energy, right? So in X-ray, if you see, when X-ray is generated, the X-ray ranges from zero to the maximum energy produces, and that is producible. And that is depending on the amount of potential difference you give for the generation of the X-ray in the cathode tube. So the more the potential energy you give, the more the range of spectrum of energy you will find for the X-ray. So it will range from, you cannot just count it. So that's why it is called a polyenergetic. While, so you cannot particularly identify one energy of the X-ray beam. So what you do, you take, as a rule of thumb, you take one third of the maximum energy as a energy of the X-ray. But for cobalt, though it has got two energies liberated in simultaneously, but you can actually identify the energies. Basically, you can identify the energy that is, it is finite. So that's why these are called monoenergetic beams. But if you go to X-ray, you cannot identify a one particular energy. It is a spectrum, basically.
Okay, the other question is, what is the difference between potential energy and binding energy?
Okay, so potential energy and binding energy. So binding energy is nothing but the energy by which the electron is bound in the atom. So it is the, basically it is usually the, if you go to the Bohr model, it is explained by, give me time. Yes. Okay, so it is, if I see the angular momentum, so if you see something is rotating in a circular fashion, we know there will be something called a centrifugal force. So it will come, say it will try to go out of the orbit because of the centrifugal force. And on the other hand, it has got something, the electrostatic force. So they will neutralize each other so that it can remain in the same orbit. And these forces can be explained by the angular momentum, which is the integral multiple of the h by 2 pi, which is basically given by the Planck's constant. So this is called the binding energy. That means, which is the energy specific to this particular shell of the orbit of the electron. And for each orbit, it is different. So that's why when one electron jumps from one orbit to another orbit, it will release an exact amount of energy, which can be explained by the h nu 1 minus h nu 2 according to the orbit. And if you see the potential energy, it is basically, if you go to the, here you can see the, it is basically the, when you have an energy which is a kinetic energy, anywhere when the charged particle is within a field of electricity and given within the potential difference, it will gain some energy. And that is known as the, that is what is the electron volt or the kinetic energy.
Okay, so the next question is, sir, can you please explain the potential well?
Again, I've just explained it.
Yeah, please explain megatron and positron emission again.
Okay. So negatron and positron emission. So basically, where the negatron will happen? So basically, you know, this is this line of stability. So here you have more neutron. Here you have more proton. So protons are positively charged. So they will want to expel positive charge and become neutral. So if you want to expel positive charge or emit positive charge, it must be something positive. So here you see positron emission. So and for the upper part, the blue one, where the there is more neutron, they will want to have more proton to get close to the np ratio of 1. So to get more proton, they needs to get rid of the negative charges, right? So if you get rid of negative charges, you will get positive charge. So that is why this will, one neutron will be converted to one proton plus one negatron and one antineutrino, and this negatron will be expelled out of the nucleus, and so this is known as negatron decay. And in here, the positron decay, one proton will change into one neutron plus one beta positive or positron, and it will, with a neutrino which has got negligible mass, and will come out as positron decay.
Okay, so the other one is, can we explain the slide showing radium and radon half-life and equilibrium?
Okay. This one, right? So yeah. The equilibrium is something, it is applicable only when the parent and daughter both are radioactive, okay? It is not applicable when the daughter is not radioactive or the daughter is removed from the system. So both of them have to be radioactive and both of them have to be in the same system, rather I will say in a closed system, to achieve an equilibrium. Equilibrium means the activity of the parent and activity of the daughter will become, the ratio of these two activity will become constant after a certain time. This is equilibrium. Equilibrium means the activity of the both parent and daughter will become constant after a certain time. Now, if you see the half-life of radium, that is almost 1600 years, and the radon is only 3.8 days. So that means the radon which is produced from the radium will be decaying again. So will be decaying before the new radons are added. So it will take more time to reach the equilibrium where the rate of decay and rate of decay of the radium and rate of decay of radon will become similar, the at least constant. The ratio becomes to be constant, where you can see the both are merging in a, or it is known as asymptotic, merging in a same line. So basically it will take a huge time, like because the radon will be decaying in a higher rate, but as the radon accumulates more, as per the theory of activity, it will achieve the equilibrium. But which is different for the transient equilibrium, where the difference between the half-lives are not much. So it will achieve the equilibrium quickly within a few hours.
Yes. So the other question is, please explain beta decay and the particles. Beta decay.
Peter, I have explained just.
Yes, just you have given. Is rate of disintegration for radium constant?
Yes, because the rate of disintegration is something you can see. It is the rate of decay of 1 gram radium. If you want to see the unit, that is Curie, it is the rate of decay of 1 gram radium. And this is basically activity. Activity is constant for any given material at a given time.
So the other questions for radioactive equilibrium, 2-3 questions. I am just that wonderful presentation. What specific activity and how it related to disintegration constant for the initial number of atoms, and how these terms are different?
Okay.
Yeah. What specific activity and
decay
how
it is something different. Yeah. Decay constant is basically. If you see the rate of decay, as we have said, the rate of decay is proportional to the number of initial element present, right? Number of initial atom present. So now, whenever it is a proportion, you can adjust the equation by a constant. And this constant is basically constant for all the, it is basically a property of a radioactive atom. So like the decay constant is a property of the radioactive atom, similarly, specific activity is also another property of radioactive atom. They are different. So this is basically the amount of activity per mass. It is like something like a density, you know. The different types of element have different types of density, which is the amount of electron per unit mass or amount of material per unit mass. So similarly, it depends on the density. So the more atoms are within a unit mass, there will be more activity. So basically, that can be explained. That can explain that they are different. These are two different properties of a radioactive element. So basically, the decay constant defines what will be the half-life, while the specific activity will define what will be the size of the isotope required to produce a similar amount of activity.
Okay. Then another question is, what is Auger electron? And the other one is binding and potential energy. Okay, fine. You have already explained binding energy.
So I need to talk about Auger electron?
Yes.
Okay, so Auger electron is nothing specific for this internal conversion only. So whenever you see a particular valence shell is empty, so it cannot be kept empty, okay? So some electron will jump from the outer orbit to fill the hole. So once the electron jumps to fill the hole, as per the law of atomic energy, it will release some energy. Now this energy, as we know, the energy will be released as a photon. So suppose there is an atom and the photon is coming from the inner shell. So photon has to traverse through the atom to come out of the atom. Now in the pathway of the photon, it interacts with another electron, which is in some shell. And as soon as the electron absorbs the energy of the photon, and if the energy of the, now the new energy of the electron is more than the binding energy, this electron will escape of the nucleus. So this is known as Auger electron because it is produced by absorption of the characteristics or phosphorescence X-ray.
Okay, so then binding energy you have explained, MeB and MB, I think this will be explained in later classes, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the fission first neutron comes from where? In fission, first neutron comes from where? That is the question.
Okay, so when the first thing is that when this uranium is bombarded with a slow neutron, so which is done is with a slow neutron, the uranium is bombarded. Now, this uranium element will spontaneously break into this elements, or it will change into barium, it will break into krypton, and it will give rise to neutrons. Now, think this entire process will generate an enormous amount of energy. And out of all this product, the energy will be distributed equally so that there no energy is lost. So apart from the energy which is radiated as heat, the other energy will be absorbed into this particular elements, and they will be acting as the kinetic energy of the elements. Now, if you compare these elements, you will see the amount of these are all heavy particles compared to neutrons, heavy nucleuses in compared to neutron. And even the energy will be going, these will have the recoil kinetic energy because of the high atomic weight, they will not move much. But because of the light weight of the neutron, they will absorb the energy and will have enormous kinetic energy. So these neutrons will be fast neutron. Now you need to make them again slow to further initiate the chain reaction, because the slow neutrons are capable of generating, causing the fission reaction.
Okay, so could you please explain that if an electron moves from outer shell to inner shell, then how the energy is emitted? Is it related to binding energy?
Yes. So, can you give me 1 minute? Just a minute. If you go to the Bohr model, you see the particular energy of orbit is fixed, right? So we can write this energy as, suppose E2 equal to H is a constant and the frequency, right? Now for this particular, the lower one also, there is some energy. So the energy will be the E2 minus E1, which can be described by the H nu 2 minus H nu 1. And if you want to see what is the nu is basically C by lambda. That means C is the speed of light and lambda is the wavelength. So it depends on the wavelength of the energy.
Okay, so other questions are explain biological half-life. That is, I think that is not this related to this topic. Do you want to explain that?
I don't think so.
Yeah, and difference between activity specific activity already explained, and characteristic X-ray, Dr. Baiwar, this will be taken in next class. We'll cover everything. So is average life is related to time to retire the source like cobalt 60?
No, usually it is calculated with half-life.
Yeah. Clinical implication of equilibrium and radiation oncology.
I don't think there is any, for radiation oncology, there is some application of clinical equilibrium. Usually the secular equilibrium is important for as it is in the nature, and the transient equilibrium is important for this generation of the technetium sources, because you can, as the technetium, as the rate of decay is achieved quite fast, and from the system, it can be constantly taken out so that the production is very expensive. So because of this equilibrium, it is the availability of technetium in a metastable state is easier. So you can quickly collect the metastable technetium and can be inserted into the body for intervention.
Okay, Dr. S. Chaitanya has asked, please explain a little about periodic table. I don't think we need to explain periodic table. We are essentially radiation oncologists and medical physicists. So that is another domain. Please explain about excited electron. Does it remain in their original orbit or it leaves the orbit?
Okay, so if there are multiple ways for the electron. Yes. So if one electron is excited, depending on the energy it is absorbing, so it can go to the outer orbit. Or if it has got so much of energy that it can be it can go out of the system, that is more than the binding energy, it can go out of the system also. So we can have more about this excitement and reaction of electron to energy in the when we'll read about
production of
interaction of photon with matter.
Yes, we have in next classes will be explained. And Kowal decay and electron capture you have explained. I don't think you need to repeat it again. So another thing is So any more questions? No, Kowal decay and electron capture. I think you have already explained, right?
Yes, electron capture I've explained. I can explain the Kowal decay once more.
Yes. And then if Dr. Sayan Das, if there is any question from YouTube, you can put it here.
Yeah. So how the cobalt is formed? One neutron by neutron bombardment. We find the we make the cobalt radioactive, which is an artificial isotope, and this cobalt decay by beta decay. And I'm not going to explain beta decay again, but the cobalt decays by beta decay, right? So it will emit one beta negatron. Now, as you see, there is one emission of the negatron. That means there will be increase in the proton number, right? Because the negative charge is expelled, so the positive charge will increase. So as the proton number changes, the element will change to nickel. Now this product from the cobalt 60, the nickel 60 will remain metastable or unstable for some time because of the reaction. And this will emit the energy in two steps by two gamma rays of 1.17 and 1.33 MeV and will become stable. So this is the gamma ray which we use for the treatment purpose. And if you know the cobalt source we have, it also decays. It decays by beta, and this beta is actually captured within the shielding material.
Dr. Sayan, is there any other question from YouTube?
No relevant questions, and some of them have already been answered in the comment section.
Okay.
Then thank you, Dr. Jivak, and thank you all the participants. It was an excellent class, and we had almost 800 people attending this class. I think one of the biggest medical physics class ever happened in the world.
Thank you.
Yes, so maybe we have created some record. So thank you all. The next class will be by Dr. Ritika Hinduja on the Thursday, that is on 3rd of September, on production of X-ray and clinical radiation generator. So we expect everybody will again join on Thursday for the next class. Thank you. Okay. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Now I am just closing this session.